Morning.
Hey, John Parker.
Coach.
How are you?
Man, I'm great. How about you?
I'm doing fine. How'd you play in the golf tournament?
You know, I played pretty well, hitting the ball well. So at this point in my game, if I'm making solid contact, I'm happy.
So you weren't in the woods where Dad was? You didn't see it? Is that where you saw him, over in the woods looking for one of his balls? Did you help
every
him
now,
find?
You know, every now and then you look up, he's in the woods. But more often than not, he's in the fairway. He's in the short stuff.
Yeah, he likes his show last week when he said that.
Yeah.
John Parker, tell me about your starting experience. It wasn't with Nick Saban, but it was. You were the first quarterback, I guess, that Coach Saban played when he got here. How different was that from your first opportunity to play quarterback at Alabama?
Yeah, so it was a lot of difference. So I started my first year would have been my sophomore year back in 2006 with Coach Shula. So. It was a lot of difference because two different mindsets, really. Coach Saban's a defensive head coach. Coach Shula was a quarterback at college, quarterback coach in the NFL for a long time, a coordinator. So he was a lot more hands-on in the offense and basically was the quarterback coach. You know, he was in all the meetings with us on the field. He was talking to us after every series because he played there. He kind of knew his offense was especially when Coach Saban came in, you know, it was a lot different just from the week to week and day to day aspect. But for the team aspect, it was night and day. And I think we all know the difference and how quickly he came in. But, you know, when Coach Saban first got there, we just knew things were going to be different if we could buy in. And it didn't take everybody long to do that. And I think you see how quickly the success turned around.
Yeah, I want to butt in just a little bit and tell you that I think Mike did a good job. You know, when he was hired, it was a tough deal for him to come in and try to be the head coach after never really running a practice and try to get the quarterbacks ready to play, try to understand academic, everything that you have to understand as a head coach. There were a lot of people who busted him, especially one guy who's in the media that treated him like a dog. But I think he was a guy who, Crabby didn't have any experience. He didn't know. He was thrown in there because of a situation that, you know, just came about. And I really have a lot of respect for him.
I've got, you know, he recruited me, and besides that, you know, people forget that we were on probation when he came in. We weren't going to a bowl games. We had limited scholarships. It was a tough time, and I think it's easy to forget that now, 10, 15 years later, but – you know, our bowl game was playing Hawaii the last game of the season, and it wasn't a bowl game. It was just trying to get the 10 scholarships that we could sign people to stay here. Then, you know, a lot of the guys that we played with in 2008 when we finally made it back to the SEC championship was guys that Coach Shula recruited. You know, we only graduated with nine seniors that year. There was nine guys, and, you know, I think he definitely – started the ball rolling to what we are today.
Well, I appreciate you saying that because I just really think if when you're going as head coach, you never have been one, and you get thrown into the turmoil that he got thrown into, and people treat him like he was a dog, that wasn't right.
Well, you combine that with the NCAA situation. I mean, it's virtually impossible. Like John Parker said, they only had 10 guys in that graduating class. I don't remember how many scholarships were taken, but a first-year head coach, and then with all the NCAA issues, that makes the job almost impossible, doesn't it, John Parker?
It really does. I mean, you're walking into basically a lose-lose situation. You know, the year before we got fired, we were a 10-win team, went to the Cotton Bowl, beat a Texas Tech team at the time that was putting up, like, you know, 50 points a game versus everybody. It was a tough situation. It's a tough situation for anybody to come in as a head coach, a new head coach, and win quickly and produce. You know, I think that's kind of where Kirby Smart might be. You know, these Georgia fans are restless over there in Athens, not winning, thinking they should be at a much higher standard. And I think that's going to be Coach Smart's biggest hurdle to overcome is the fans' expectations. You know, Coach Saban, he kind of ruined it for the other coaches. As quickly as he won, everybody else in the country expects their program to do the same thing. That's tough to replicate and to win as quickly as he did. I think that's going to be Coach Kirby Smart's biggest deal to deal with over there.
John Parker, we had Emma Talley on a couple of weeks ago, the great golfer in Alabama, and we talked to her about her recruitment out of high school, and she started taking visits, she said, in the eighth grade, but she told Dad and I she took 18 visits before she decided to go, which we were blown away. Go back to your days in the high school and your recruiting. Was it always Alabama, or did you actually take some other visits? Just kind of talk about the recruiting process that you went through.
Yeah, for me, it was basically all Alabama. So my family grew up there in Tuscaloosa. You know, all my grandparents, aunt, uncle, everybody was there in Tuscaloosa and still is. And, you know, I took some other, like, unofficial visits to Tennessee and Ole Miss, went over to Georgia and a couple other schools. But when it came down to it, when Coach Shula offered me a scholarship, it was a no-brainer. You know, I committed early. You know, a lot of these guys will wait till February. I think I committed, you know, in December just because, you know, I get a chance to play for my school that I grew up pulling for. It was really a no-brainer for me.
What advice would you give to Jake Coker? I see you were undrafted but played in the NFL, and here, you know, he's had a great year, won the national championship. Have you talked to Jake about the NFL and the process of him going through? What would you tell Jake?
Yeah, you know, I think he's got a leg up on everybody else, and Coach Saban definitely gets you ready for that. Being in a high pressure program like what Alabama is, so it'll be a much easier transition for him going to the NFL, because basically it's going to be harder what we did in Alabama than what he's expected to do in the pros. But you know, he's got to go out there and win a job and win it from somebody else. There's going to be three or four quarterbacks out there competing. And it basically comes down to making the most of your opportunities. It's tough because you don't get a lot of reps, you don't get a lot of chances, but when you go out there, you got to perform, and you know, you got to perform at a high level. So it's a lot of things going in. You can't let the pressure, you can't let the situation get too big for you. You got to go out there and basically win a job with a few reps. So I think if anybody could do it, it's him, just showing what he did last year. The leadership that he showed, you know, obviously he's very talented, but I think people are going to look for that in a backup quarterback. If this guy has to go in the fourth quarter at the end of the game, you know, he's got the poise and the history to go in there and show that he can do it.
Yeah, how is your situation with Atlanta? I know you're on, the Texas squad, so to speak, or played some. Just give our listeners a little bit about your Atlanta experience.
Well, yeah, I was actually on the roster. I came in just like Coker as an undrafted guy, and beat out the backup that was there and was able to be on the roster for 3 years. It's completely different experience than college. It's great, but you know, it's a job, it's a business, and a lot of moves, a lot of people get shaken up. So I'm just was lucky enough to play there for 3 years, and then finished my fourth year up down in Jacksonville. So it was, you know, a huge opportunity for me. And I know, you know, the great thing about Alabama now, a lot of guys are going to go play and get to do that for a few years after school and really just springboard in your career for what you're going to do next.
John Parker, tell us about Coach Saban, you know, you guys' relationship with him, even after your three plays. I know you only played for him for 1 year, but, you know, that – I think he gets the Alabama football program, all the former players that go all the way back. Just kind of talk about you guys' relationship with Coach after you get through playing with it for him.
Well, luckily, I spent 2 years with him. So the first year was him coming in there and really changing everything up, shaking it up. And then as we spent more time together, obviously, you know, the relationship grows. And it still is today. You know, like seeing out on the golf course on Monday when we were out there for the athletic department. It's fun to be able to you know, sit back and watch it now from a different perspective, because I was in there, got to see and know exactly how the program was run, and now to get to sit back and look at it as a fan, you know, it's just fun to watch him go out there and be consistently winning. I think you know, we'll see blips on the radar, and one team will get hot one year, or, you know, make it to the playoffs or make a run in their conference. But for him to be able to do it year after year with different players, and now, you know, as much as the coaches are turning over with coordinators and position coaches, I think it's just a testament to the way he's running his program and how consistent he's been able to be.
Well, I want to say this. I think I'm correct. Aren't you expecting a child?
Yeah, I guess so. We are.
I think you may announce something you weren't supposed to there, Dad.
Oh man, yeah, we're getting ready. We might be expecting so. It's still a little early, and we could be blessed with a child here in the near future.
Well, I hope you are, because the only reason I said that is because Barry's expecting one too.
Yeah. Hey, we had a guy call in a little while ago, and I said, he said you were one of his favorite players at Alabama. I said, all right, Kevin, what do you want me to ask him? He said, will you please ask him? I saw him on TV one time, and he had on a Boston Red Sox hat. Please tell me he's not a Boston Red Sox fan. So that was the question that he wanted me to ask you. Are you a Boston Red Sox fan or not?
So, you know, I'm a huge Braves fan. And I grew up a Braves fan. I can remember being over my, you know, my grandfather and dad always had it on the TV back when they were TBS. So always pulled up a Braves fan. Still am a Braves fan. You know, kind of like the Red Sox. Everybody's got to have an American League team.
Yeah.
I really like the Red Sox organization, the program, the history they have. There was a point in my lifetime that I kind of pulled for the Red Sox, but I've been a Braves fan through and through.
Well, he'll be happy then. Last question I got, you know, I see you played a little bit your freshman year, but, you know, not maybe as much as you wanted to, or maybe you realized you weren't ready, then you had to wait your time. But you see so many guys now, when they get to college and they don't play right away, especially in basketball, not maybe quite as much in football, but they want to transfer immediately. Mm-hmm. Just talk about the, you know, a guy who maybe is in there, may not start this year, but just being patient. Obviously, you started playing your sophomore year, but being patient and waiting your turn and being ready when you call instead of running from the situation when you don't play right away.
Yeah, you know, I think when you come to a program like Alabama, there's going to be a ton of good players in front of you, and I think there's a lot to be learned from those older guys. I mean, I got to sit for 2 years and watch, you know, Brody go out there, watch what was successful for him, watch what didn't work. I think that was huge to be able to just, you know, be humble. First off, you're humbled by the experience because, you know, you're playing – every snap in high school, every snap when you're younger, then you come up and you realize there's a lot of guys. So you're humbled immediately, but then to sit back and be able to learn, I think that was huge for me. I think it's huge for any young players is to you know, really understand the nuances of the game. It's so different from high school coming to the college or from college to the NFL. You know, you look at someone like Aaron Rodgers who sat behind Brett Favre for 3 or 4 years. Look how he turned out.
Right. Matt,
well, tell our listeners what you're doing.
So I'm actually just joined a group based out of Tuscaloosa with Morgan Stanley, financial advisor. We do wealth management, and we have an office there in Tuscaloosa. So luckily I'm getting to come back, spend a ton of time, you know, serving clients and then meeting a lot of people. And for me, it's been very rewarding because, you know, you're in it playing, and now I get to come back and really – work with these people who were once pulling for me, and it's just been it's been great for me and for my wife to be able to move back here and to get back in the community and to be able to do this now with Morgan Stanley has been a huge platform for us.
Where's your wife from?
She's actually from Atlanta. So I met her over at school, met her in Tuscaloosa, and then when we got done playing, we came back to Birmingham. So we've been back for a few years, and it's been good to be back home.
Well, I didn't mean to give anything away, but anyway.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
But
the internet is blowing up.
This boy right here, I got to play with him once or twice, not this time. He can hit it a mile.
Can he?
Yeah.
Half the time we don't know where it's going, though. So that's the problem. You got to dial down to the 3-wood.
Well, you know, you're perfect for a guy in one of the deals where you play the best ball or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
So you let. get one ball out in the fairway and then let you tee it high and let it fly. And you try to smash one down there as far as you can. That's how you do it.
If we can get one out of the fairway, we're trying to stick it out there like 330. So
Most
of the time it doesn't work out, but every now and then I'll connect one to get it out there pretty good.
Well, yeah. Well, John Parker, we appreciate you being
on. Thank you for being on, John Parker.
Enjoy it, guys. We'll do it again soon.